Hi everyone, welcome back. In this video, we will discuss about kernel source tree and we will try to build a custom kernel. So let's get started. This is the content that I will be discussing in this video. To build a custom kernel, we need its source code. So we can download the source code from kernel.org website, or we can use this git clone command to download it. After downloading, we can unzip it with the help of this tar command. Then if we want to change the version of the downloaded kernel, then we can do that with the help of a patch file. We can apply a patch with patch command with -p1 option. Later, if we want to revert the applied patch, then we can use this command with -r option, which will revert the applied patch. This is the path where generally Linux kernel is installed. This is the brief description of different directories inside kernel source code. Directory arc contains code specific for different kind of architectures. Drivers directory contains code for different device drivers. FS directory contains code for virtual file system and different file systems it supports. Similarly, in the kernel directory, it contains code for core subsystems, including scheduler and interrupt handler. MM directory contains code for memory management. Likewise, other directories contain code for different utilities of kernel. So let's download the source code and apply the patch. This is the kernel.org website. From here, you can download the source code and patch file. If you want to download the previous versions of kernel, then you can visit this website. Here, you will find different versions of kernel as well as its patch files. I am downloading Linux 5.8 kernel and patch file 5.8.1. So as you can see that I have downloaded both the files and extracted them. So let's see how we can apply the patch. First, we have to see what the patch is doing. It is making many changes, so we have to focus on one change. So here you can see that it is making some change in the make file. It is setting sublevel value from 0 to 1. So as you can see that currently the sublevel value is 0. So after applying the patch, it should be 1. So I have applied the patch. Let's again visit the makefile. As you can see that the sublevel value has changed to 1. Now let's revert the applied patch. So you can see that sublevel value has changed from 1 to 0. That means our patch has been reverted. Now let's visit what's inside the source code. So here you can see that it contains all the directories that we have already discussed. So if we go inside FS directory, you will find code for different kind of file systems the Linux kernel supports. Here you can see these are the different file systems that Linux kernel support, including ext2, ext4, hat, ntfs, ufs. To get familiar with the Linux source code, you can visit each and every directory and see what they are containing inside them. Now, let's discuss how we can build the kernel. After downloading the source code, we can build the kernel. But before building the kernel, we have to configure it for specific architectures. All the configurations are saved in .config file. Each configuration options will decide which files to build and to manipulate code via preprocessor directives. Configuration options can be of different type, including Boolean, tri-state, int, or string. We have different options to configure the kernel. First one is make config. This is the manual way where it will prompt for each configuration to say yes, no, or tri-state. Make menu config is an curses based graphical utility where you can choose which configurations to keep. Similarly, make gconfig is GTK based graphical utility. Make dev config is default configuration for a specific architecture. If you don't know what you are changing, then you can keep dev configurations. Else you can also change .config file directly. After changing the file, you can run make old config to validate and update the configurations. After configuring the kernel, we can run make command, which will build the whole kernel. If you want to minimize the output of this make command, then you can run this make command. Here, slash dev slash null is a big sink with no return. So when we run make command, it will spawn a single thread to build the kernel, which can be slow. So we can specify how many threads we want to generate by minus j option. After building the kernel, we can install the generated modules from make modules install command. This is the sequence of commands to build a Linux kernel. Here we are taking example of 5.9.6. These are the packages required to build a kernel. For example, ncurses is used to set configuration options of kernel. This command copies the configuration file of already installed kernel into the new source code. So let's try to build kernel 5.9.6. So here we have installed different packages and we have extracted the downloaded source code. Now we can copy the config file from already installed kernel. It has copied the config file. And you can see that the currently installed kernel is 5.12.0. So let's make the default configurations. So we can run dev config. make it to 2, 4, or 8, or 16, depending on how many processors or core your computer has. So I am giving it to 2. It will take some time depending on the number of jobs you have spawned. It may take around 30 minutes to 1 hour. It will generate different kind of modules depending on the config file. So guys, I have rebooted the device. Now let's check what is the current kernel version. So as you can see that our kernel has changed to 5.9.6. So in this way we can change our kernel. You can see that I have run all the commands. So these are the commands that we already discussed. If you have multiple kernels in your system and you want to reboot the system with different kernel version, then press shift after rebooting the device. It will display the grub where we can choose the kernel version. If you want to make a particular kernel permanent, then you can go to the default and grub file where you have to change the kernel version and then update the grub file. So let's see how we can change the kernel version. This is the grub display. Here we can choose the particular kernel version if we have multiples in our system. So let me choose 5.8.0, press enter. Now again we can check the kernel version. So you can see that this is the kernel version that we have selected. So in this way you can change between the kernels. So let's discuss the nature of the Linux kernel. Linux kernel don't have standard C library. In place of that, it has its own functions. For example, in place of printf, in kernel space we have printk function. Both the functions are very similar to each other. The kernel is coded in GNU C. So GNU C is different kind of C. Here you can use inline functions and it also has the feature of inline assembly code. So inside C we can embed the architecture specific instructions. Also it has specific branch annotation functions, likely and unlikely. These functions are used when we know something a priori. In the kernel space we don't have memory protection because there is no one to monitor it. But when user space or process tries to access an illegal memory location, then kernel can trap it and kill the process. In the kernel space, there is no use of floating point instructions. When user space processes use floating point instructions, then kernel gets a trap and then it starts conversion of integer to floating point. But when floating point instructions are used in kernel space, then there is no one to trap the kernel, and for specific architectures it has to save and restore the floating point registers and do other stuff to support the floating point instructions. So we should not use floating point instructions in the kernel code. Kernel has very small stack size for every process. Kernel also supports synchronization and concurrency. It supports preemptive multitasking. It means that if a process is running, kernel can preempt it and reschedule the different process. Symmetric multitasking. It means that same kernel code can run on multiple processors simultaneously. All these features are supported by kernel with the help of spin locks and semaphores. For Linux kernel, portability is important. As we know that Linux supports different kind of architectures, so portability is very important. So in conclusion, we can say that Linux kernel is not that scary. We can tinker with it and play with it, like we have seen how we can build our custom kernel and we can run in our running OS. This is all for this video. I will see you in the next video.